Good evening and welcome to the January 26, 2017 meeting of the Radnor Township Environmental Advisory Council. Our first order of business is the election of officers. This is what we do at the first meeting of every calendar year. And I have notified the group that I'm going to be stepping down as chairperson. I've been chairperson for 4 years now. 2012, I think. It must have been the end of 2012 when Brenda left. And it's been a lot of fun. But I think it's a good. It would be good for some new blood, some fresh meat up here. To we've had some turnover as well, so I think it might be a good time to for me to step down. I've told the group that. I also told the group that I'm staying on to finish my term, which I believe is probably another 2 years or so. So I'll stay on as a member and an active member at that. And I also would like to take this opportunity to nominate a new chairperson. And Matt, you have graciously agreed to accept that kind of a nomination beforehand. So I'm not afraid of you declining that, right? Yeah.
No, I'm in. Thank you. I appreciate the nomination.
Sloan has been our faithful vice chairperson almost for the same amount of time, if not the exact same amount of time. And you've also agreed to accept my nomination as a vice chairperson.
I have. Thank you.
Okay, great. I guess, so I will make the motion, I guess, formally that Matt be the chairperson, Sloan, vice chairperson. Anybody second that?
I'll second that motion.
And all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All right.
Even though we have two people that are not present, they did express verbally that they were supporting these nominations. I just didn't. I failed to get their proxy vote. So it's a 5-0.
And Josh, I'd like to thank you for your leadership in these last several years. You've been energetic and a great guide for us. So thank you.
Well, shucks. Our second order of business, our approval of last month's minutes. We did meet at the beginning of December. I was not present at that meeting, unfortunately, but are there any changes to the minutes from that meeting? I'd like to get a motion to approve them.
So moved.
I'll second it. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Announcements. I only have one announcement. Feel free to step in if you have one too. I'd like to announce that the Radnor Conservancy is promoting a film that they're showing here in this building. I guess they show these films in this room. I guess I'm not even sure. I haven't been to one of their films, but it is Tuesday, February 21st at 7 o'clock in the evening. The film is called The Batman of Mexico. And this is very interesting. This is a well-known film around the country. It's about a gentleman named Rodrigo Medellin. He's a professor at the National Autonomous University in Mexico City. And his passion over the past couple years has been the lesser long-nosed bat. It ranges over much of Mexico and the American Southwest. It's the primary pollinator of agave plants. Apparently, the population of these bats has severely dwindled at one in the past, and threatened the agave crop, which is the tequila basin for tequila. apparently, we now know where Rodrigo is, where he does in the evenings. So it was placed on the U.S. Endangered Species List in 1988, and was also on the Mexican similar list in Mexico in 1994. 22 years he spent on the project, and Medellin has contributed significantly to the rebounding of the populations of this bat. So this is a story about the Batman of Mexico. That's my only announcement. Anybody else have any other announcements? Okay. Moving on, and what I'm going to do is I'm going to shuffle the agenda a bit since we have some public comment, apparently. So what I'm going to do is invite that now. And the microphone should be on, so just have your name and address, and let us know what you want to talk about.
Thank you. My name is Roberta Winters, and I live on 326 Williams Road in Rosemont. And in recent years, and I've been attending more township meetings than I've ever attended in my life. As when I attend township meetings, I've heard things that I thought might have an impact on our environment, and maybe the Environmental Advisory Committee should be doing something in a way that might be proactive, or at least advise the commissioners in areas or other committees that are working on some of these projects. And I just didn't know what the role was, so I looked online, and I read you have a very important role, and, you know, we all appreciate what you do, and we have a wonderful staff in our township that works very hard to maintain our environment. We have very conscientious elected officials who try to do the same, but there's a lot going on in the township, and it's hard to keep your finger on what's happening. And so one of the things I just wanted to mention to you is, like, in the last couple of months, for example, at the commissioners' meeting this past Monday, they talked about the potential of on-site sewage on a lot where there were some steep slopes and some issues like that. And I thought, well, maybe the Environmental Advisory Council should say something about on-site sewage, because I wasn't sure that was something that we would particularly embrace in Radnor Township. Not that it's definite, but it's something that I thought maybe the Environmental Advisory Committee would like to have a word about. I've heard meetings where we've talked about air quality and dust. I've been at meetings where we've talked about the potential of perhaps daylighting a stream. We've talked about things at other committees that I've heard where they've talked about, you know, monitoring the water quality in the areas where there's development occurring. So I just don't know when the EAC says something in an advisory role, or if you wait until you're asked, or exactly how it all plays out in the big system. And I think it would be helpful for me to know, because sometimes, because I tend to be somewhat visible in the community, people come to me and they ask me questions. And it's always nice to have a way to provide some input and send them in the right direction. So that's why I'm coming tonight, because I just don't know exactly when and how we should come to you, and if in fact that's the appropriate channel to use, if it comes from the bottom up or the top down, in other words. Okay, thanks, or both.
Thanks for coming in, Roberta. I appreciate your comment. You are correct in that we were formed as an advisory council to the Board of Commissioners, and we serve at their behest, and we. I guess our primary role is to advise them, whether it be they're asking for our help or we've been notified elsewhere that there is something that they should be advised about, about any matter that is, you know, related to the health of the environment or the beings in that environment. Now, of course, now if we're talking about human health, we allow that to slide over to the Board of Health, of course. And it's so, like I said, it's come both ways. It's come from top down and bottom up. We encourage the residents of Radnor Township to use us as a sounding board or as a liaison to the Board of Commissioners. We've had people approach us. I'm trying to think of a top-down example would be somebody was concerned about the use of pesticides, the township's use of pesticides. They approached their commissioner, and the commissioner said that's something that we need. You know, they're not experts on, so let's say we'll send that to the EAC and get their opinion on. That's an example of that. We've also had people concerned about, I remember one about a street light. We had been converting some street lights to LEDs, and I seem to recall a resident coming straight to us about the concerns about the street lights and light pollution kind of concerns. So I think that one might have been a good example of the bottom up. So both. I don't think we have, of the three things or three or four things you might have mentioned right there specifically, I'm not aware of those issues. We haven't been approached by anybody. I don't believe about any of that.
I know the issue, I think.
Do you?
I think the daylighting of the stream is Maya, the riverkeeper, suggested that the stream going through the development at Villanova, the underground right now through the parking lot, could be exposed to light again. And she sent a letter to us and to the commissioners, and from my understanding, nothing in particular happened. That doesn't mean it couldn't happen. It just meant that that's how I know about it. And then I think the on-site sewage thing, if that was very recent, that was the Wellwind Road project, and that's because they're allowed to do that, and the lots are so huge, there's plenty of room to accommodate that. That's just on-site septic. I mean, I have that down at the shore. It depends where you live. There is a sewer in the street there, and if it was cheaper, I'm sure the developer would connect to the sewer in the street.
So Skip.
So I know those two things, that's all.
Skip sits up here with us as our liaison to the Planning Commission. That's why he knows so much about that particular on-site sewage thing. And you're right, I forgot about the daylighting of the stream. Maya did come and talk to us about that. I'm not sure if that answered all or any of your questions. It helps. Yeah, and so I would encourage anybody with concerns to either approach us directly or their local their commissioner.
Right,
and we would obviously.
Yeah, I would just emphasize or agree and just say, you know, it's an open door for all sorts of issues, and if you or somebody you're talking with has an environmental issue, whether it's gone before the Board of Commissioners or not, please let them know or feel free to come and tell us about it, and we'll do what we can to look at it, research it, and if it's, you know, at that level or at that point in the issue, we'd be happy to consider, you know, passing on some advice to the board. So consider it an open invitation.
And for what it's worth, we are televised, so when we address some of these things, it may stimulate additional discussion by the public.
Just one point I wanted to bring up is, and I'm not aware of whether this is true or not, but is there any contact information for anyone on the EAC listed on the Radnor Township website in case someone wanted to bring an issue to us directly without having to come to the meeting?
That's a fair question. I don't know if there are. I don't think my email address.
Who
is? Oh.
Yeah.
Oh. They might have our liaison to the municipal employee here.
Uh-huh.
And right now it should be Ben Cooper. Yep. Now whether or not I don't think our personal email addresses are on there. So.
No.
But certainly Ben acts as our liaison, and anytime there's a commissioner or a resident that has an issue, he always is the one that's forwarding that kind of stuff to me.
Okay, just wanted to make sure there was a possible way of that.
That's a good question, yeah. Yep, thanks. Any other public comment?
Well, Rick Leonardi, Alderman Lane, I'm on the care group, and relative to the daylighting of the stream issue, I didn't really come prepared to speak tonight. I don't have a formal presentation to make. Hearing what you've just said about your role and the means of accessing the advice and expertise of the committee, I think it's probably better for me to go back and prepare something and then get it to you. But just as a heads up, what I think is probably brewing at the DRN and other places is a pretty strong case that the water that flows through the Alwyn Triangle on the south side of the embankment away from the Villanova dorm project that's being built now is actually a continuation of water that can be found on the north side of the tracks. In as much as the water south side of the tracks, it enjoys a 50-foot riparian buffer and a good deal of wetland protection, the water on the north side probably should be looked at and protected in a similar fashion. The daylighting option is only one way of finessing that question, but where the matter stands today is that water source on the north side is being described as a stagnant pool, it's being pretty much aggressively ignored by competent authorities. It didn't even show up on the site survey that Villanova developed and generated and promulgated to the public, which is a pretty serious oversight, in as much as we can now prove that the two sources are connected. So that's what's coming. Be prepared.
Thank you, Rick. And DRN is the Delaware Riverkeeper Network, in case anybody was wondering. Great. Any other public comment? Okay, so I'm going to shuffle back to our original agenda and start with our work group reports. It's going to be, what I'd like to do is kind of reboot for the 2017 a little bit. So if you don't mind, I'm going to just touch on some old subjects that we might have wrapped up. Sorry? Ah, yes, of course, yes. Phil, what can I get you on here? He's got 45 minutes. He just wants to hang out and listen to our talk. Okay, so the first thing is going to be the sustainable community certification that we've been talking about. It's called Sustainable Pennsylvania Community Certification. Sloan, why don't you take this subject?
Yeah, sure. This is the effort to encourage the township to get certified as a sustainable community. This is an initiative that is done across the states at the township level, and it's a lot like LEED certification for buildings. So you can gain higher certification levels for adding sustainable practices, and those practices, of course, include environmental practices like recycling, but are not exclusively environmental. It also looks to good financial planning, which Radnor has enjoyed quite a bit of success on that front, and other good government practices. So, Roberta, that may be of interest to you. We've begun looking at the certification, Phil, Commissioner from the 7th Ward, has kindly looked at it with us and suggested some follow-up work that we should do basically to move the ball forward. So we're gonna look into the benefits to the township of doing this. Particularly, there's certainly hopefully some good. Reputational benefits, but I think there may also be other benefits in terms of access to grants and other things. So we'll do some work around that and report back. Phil, I think you had some other questions, which we appreciate, and we'll circle back with that. Our hope would be to do the analysis, find that the benefits are worth whatever costs there are. There aren't any, hard costs that we've come across at this point, but there may be costs in terms of getting it, implemented. And then make the case up the ladder and see and hopefully get some traction at the township level. What we like, as we've talked about in previous meetings, it's got a lot of the things that we've been working on here at the EAC for quite a few years, parts of our greenhouse gas action plan, which the board asked us several years ago to implement in order to reduce the township's carbon footprint as much as we can. So a lot of those things are in that certification program. Things like, let's be as efficient as we can with our fleet and other initiatives that we've been working on. It's not just that, but it's definitely partially that. So we view this as a way to further that long-term project as well. So that's where we are. We've got some homework to do, which we will do, and hopefully we'll get a good dialogue going, with the staff and with the commissioners.
Did we ever put together a work group, an official work group?
No, we don't have a work group. I think that would be great because we might be able to sort of parcel out different questions.
I think so because you just asked a couple things that we have to do some research on.
Yeah, we do.
Like costs.
Benefits. Costs, and then who would do what to actually implement the project, meaning, you know, to fill in the application, maintain it, track it. I think the EAC hopefully would be interested in helping to track it as we go forward, but certainly there'd be a role at the township staff level, probably. We thought in previous discussions that it might be a nice role, an organizing role for the green team, the staff team at the township. A few open issues, and you know, if anybody's interested in helping, I think a task force would be great.
Yeah, sounds good. Thank you, Sloan, on that.
Should we
do it right now?
If anybody's interested, great. That's great. Andrew's interested. Why don't we circle up after the meeting and we can sort of talk about what the next steps are.
Great.
Phil, did you want to add anything?
Thanks, Sloan. I think I reviewed the material that you sent over to me.
Yeah.
And the website is particular. I think it was very interesting. I saw it was a great momentum, that we have an opportunity to be one of the first townships in this area, Southeast Pennsylvania, to take on this certification. So it's worth exploring. And I did give you a list of questions, mostly about what are the clear benefits of it, so that we would know what we're looking for, and what any additional costs that may be associated to it, or practices that we'd have to do that we don't do. I reviewed fairly extensively some of the criteria for getting the certification, and of course, as you know, there's different levels of certification that townships have achieved, and I thought that many of them we had already achieved or were close to achieving.
I think
could
that's
be
right.
Considered that way. So it looked like there was a lot of things that were within our grasp, and that it would be a good. More than a feather in a cap. I think the mission of this is to reduce costs for townships and to create opportunities and to kind of spark innovation. And if we were able to do those kind of things, I think that would be a benefit to our community and a good spot for other communities in our area to kind of latch onto as well. So I wish you luck and you know, get together a small piece of what this would be like, and then I think it would be appropriate to certainly involve the township manager and staff, at least in terms of just getting their thoughts on it, and then bring it up to the Board of Commissioners to see if we can get some light under that fire to see if we can get Great. Things moving a little bit more on that and charge you more officially with that.
Great, will do. Well, Good. Thank you very much for looking into it, and we will work on it.
Thanks. Yeah. Thanks for bringing it up.
I hope it's a large part of our efforts this year.
I think that's right.
I think. It does seem like something that would take that kind of time.
I think so.
A year, and we're happy to dig into it as our time allows.
It seemed to work hand in glove with some of the green team things that you have been talking about, and it went well beyond that. And more, it was financial. It was community development. So it was very, very, very comprehensive in a way. So I think it was a nice way to look at the township and to get a score for ourselves in that way and see where we fit.
So that's right.
I think
that's
we can
right.
do it.
Yeah, thanks. Well, thank you.
Thanks, Phil, and thanks for coming to the meeting. Dan, do you mind giving us an update on the water quality citizen science project? You might have given one last month that I missed, but is there anything?
Actually, I think Matt's the one kind of running.
Oh, that one's me.
But, oh, yeah. Sorry.
But
sorry.
I've got
that's
something
all right.
else to talk about.
I'm happy to give you an update, although
Thank
Dan
you.
Was involved in the most recent thing that we did related to that, which was Darby Creek Valley Association held their annual insect identification workshop over at the rec center at Haverford. Very nice facility over there. What they did is last year at one of their stream monitoring events, they used kick nets to get sediment from Darby Creek from the bottom of the stream And during the workshop, we looked at the leaves that were pulled out of those kick nets and identified insects. We pulled little insects out of it. Two of my kids were involved, and they had a great time, and we're going to try to use that as part of the process as we get going with this stream monitoring project in the future. So we won't know if we get any money from the state for that until April, but at the same time, I think there are a lot of activities that are relatively low cost that we could get school kids involved in, and I think they would get a lot out of it, in addition to contributing to some efforts that I think would really help with local monitoring efforts.
And do you see this as something that might move forward even in the event that the grant doesn't come through?
Absolutely. I think it's going to require some work to kind of beat the bushes and get some volunteers out. But assuming that there's interest, and I think there might be, there are a lot of things that we could do with very little investment of money that would allow us to, you know, actually collect some data and get a good sense of what's going on. Just to give you a sense, my daughter Layla and I and my son Ben have been working on getting samples from the local area around our house. We went across the street to look at the West Wayne Preserve, which is right near my house, right. And we collected a little sample there to compare with what comes out of the kind of the living stream beds. It's really gross. And my daughter looked at it. She couldn't find any bugs. I think we found one earthworm. She said, this is not a healthy stream at all. So we learned something, and I think she's going to make a science fair project out of that. And so that's something where, again, it doesn't take a lot of effort, doesn't take a lot of startup capital. We just need to kind of organize a little bit.
The other point to consider is, even if there's no funding, the watershed classroom in the middle school already does a lot of this. But they're maintaining the data inside the classroom. So if there was some way to share that data outside, there's a lot of data already available.
So. Yeah, and you've been in contact with the school district to some degree.
I have, yeah.
You're familiar with the watershed.
I spoke to the watershed teachers a little bit, and they gave us some great ideas. So, and I'll also mention, as part of the grant proposal process, we got a signed letter from DCVA saying that they would partner with us in terms of, you know, providing technical support and maybe a little bit of training and things like that. So, you know, we didn't ask them for anything in particular in terms of material support, but we figured it's a good way to make some connections and build some relationships there.
You would say that the EAC is the lead in this, or is the Darby Creek?
The EAC is definitely the lead here. This is a Radnor Township project.
Right. Because this is it's a municipal grant. It has to go to a...
That's correct. Right. So we would have to administer it. And, you know, it's really, from my point of view, the value of it, you know, it's a small grant. It's $3,000 tops, which would pay for some nice equipment. But again, to me, the value of it is doing a little bit of research on what's needed out there, what other organizations are doing, and maybe building some liaisons. I met a couple of people at that workshop, Dan. I don't know if you talked to any of those guys, but there were a couple of people, one of whom was with the EAC in Lower Merion, who expressed an interest in maybe getting together at some point and talking about projects and sharing ideas. So I think there's a lot of potential for partnership.
And how you doing on, you know, I guess there's not much to do now until the grant.
Not much to do. I think the next step would be just in an informal way to go to the schools and see if there's interest in starting some little informal clubs to get kids out to the local streams and try to practice some of these techniques.
Before April?
Possibly, yeah, depending on the weather.
Do you need any more help from the EAC or?
I'll reach out to folks if we get to that point, but really right now it's enough, I think, for me to poke around and send some emails out. I'll let you know what happens.
Just one other idea would be, there's, I think, two or three active Boy Scout troops in the township, so they also may be good resources for getting out and collecting data.
That's a great idea. I like that. I'm involved with Troop 284. I know there's some other troops as well. And yeah, I think that some of these things might make a good scout project. A lot of kids need service hours and things like that.
Yeah.
Great idea.
Yeah.
Thanks, Matt. And I also want to make it clear that this is Matt's meeting. I'm just, we agreed ahead of time to that I would run it for him for this meeting. So, Chairperson, I'm not trying to usurp your...
Thank you for doing that while I learned the ropes. I appreciate it.
Ah, yes.
The thought was to collect data and share it with one or more organizations that are collecting data nationally. There are some organizations that have made websites available, and I don't remember the names of them off the top of my head, but there are a number of organizations that are doing this on a fairly large scale. So a next step in the project is really to investigate that and see what we can do in terms of data sharing. I think that would make it much more valuable. I'd love to be able to collect data in a structured way and actually use it for something rather than just have it be an educational project. That's right. But we won't know until April if we get funding for the project. So that's when we'll make some of those decisions.
And if you find some issue?
Mm-hmm. Oh, I think, yeah, it's a good point. We, you know, sharing data in a scientific way, you know, may be less timely than just actually coming to the township, coming to the Board of Commissioners and saying, look, we've identified a problem. Something needs to be looked into more deeply. I think it's a good point. I don't know. We're at a very early stage of the process right now. Yeah, thanks for that.
I also wanted to touch on a bamboo ordinance we had been working on towards the end of the year. The last I had any contact with that, I had made a visit to the shade tree meeting and expressed the EAC's support for the ordinance and offered to help out if we could. But I sort of lost touch over the past month about what's been happening. Skip, do you mind just...
I'm also liaison to Shade Tree. We had a meeting yesterday. Our chair chose not to really work on the bamboo ordinance until February and said in part that he thought he was still waiting for more guidance from EAC. I didn't correct him at that point because I'm not sure if he had spoken to you separately or, you know, how that went. But I think didn't we sort of already do this?
Well, you went to.
Yeah, I thought so.
It might be worth sending Jack an email saying that, you know, when we appeared, our position hasn't really changed. We're generally supportive, although some of us have reservations about $1,000 a day fines and things like that. Well, maybe they're never collected, but seems extreme to me still. Just saying.
750 better?
100 better?
I'm kidding. Okay, I'll make sure I contact Jack and tell him what offer our help, because that's what we offered. We said if they want help fine-tuning pieces of it, looking into research, you know, we're happy to help, but I didn't realize that they were waiting for us.
We had a stack of paper. We killed many trees last night that was this high, and I think that was part of it.
Oh, okay. Not about bamboo, I'm assuming.
Well,
right.
Not exactly.
One other thing I wanted to touch on. And this one is Dan, I think. Did you ever have any success? We're talking about Sustainable Parks Work Group. We had hoped to maybe have some kind of early work starting right around now in terms of putting together a plan for Skunk Hollow, I think it was, right?
Yeah. In fact, I just wrapped this up this week. I mean, I have something on paper now. My next step is to get it out to the Community Garden, Radnor Conservancy, and Radnor Birdtown. They're all very interested and supportive of it.
So I meant to say this is a meadowization. It might be a term that we made up. We're not sure.
I hope so.
We should probably patent it. But it was the idea that where you take a turf field, which is of grasses that are typically not native grasses, And mowed on a regular basis, and change it into a native wild grasses and native grasses, native plants that are mowed way less often.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
So sorry.
Yeah, that's okay. Yeah. So it's been going on for about a year. We've identified a spot near the community garden, sort of between the willows and Skunk Hollow there, right up against the composting operation at Skunk Hollow. Parks Department or Parks and Rec supported that location. I know the community garden people think it's a good location. They've got some beehives there. They think it might be, you know, a nice feature to add there. So I'm just trying to push that forward now. Probably in the next week I'll send out a plan to all of you, and you're welcome to make any comments. It's a pretty straightforward operation. First step is to kill all the grass that's there, and the community garden people are very adamant that there's no chemicals to be used for that, and I fully support that. So there's simple ways of just laying down newspaper or cardboard and getting some mulch on top of it, letting it sit for a couple months. So we could potentially do that this year still. We want to have seeds in the ground by sort of mid-May at the latest, or it gets too hot for things to... You just have to spend the whole summer watering them if you don't do that. So I'm going to make a big push now and see if we can make it happen this year.
Is there anything that we can help in the next couple of weeks besides reviewing it?
I'll just kind of keep you in all the emails and, just keep the morale high. I'm going to mention just a couple other quick things. Matt mentioned the event we were at last Saturday morning with the Darby Creek Valley Association. There were a couple guys here very active in the watershed, and they have some concerns about that composting operation. And there's a berm along the creek that may have failed in some locations and would just like to look at it. They're concerned that some of this compost is getting into the stream, and it's basically adding a lot of nutrients to the stream that shouldn't really get there. So I want to go check it out, and then I'll talk to Public Works and see if something should be done or can be done. And then the last thing, I'm going to be sitting in on the Radnor Trail Extension Study Group, which seems to meet about once a month, just as sort of an EAC liaison. Radnor Conservancy people are on that, Radnor Birdtown, and then the landscape architects and engineers that are actually designing the project. So it's more just a lot of personal interest, but I think it's a good thing to have a link to with the EAC.
Great. That's it. Thanks, Dan.
Yeah, and Dan, please do let us know how that's going. That trail project's really important and be very interesting to hear.
I know from the minutes I got from them today that, I mean, they've cleared the right-of-way. They're in the midst of surveying it, so I mean, it's full speed ahead right now. I don't know what the I would imagine they're thinking of constructing it this summer if they're doing that now.
Right.
So,
did I understand there's a tunnel?
Yeah, my understanding is we filled in that tunnel when the trail got built, but now they're going to re-excavate it, is my understanding.
B&W tunnel.
And you'll now go under, what road is that?
Radnor Chester.
Yeah.
Okay. Oh, neat.
And I'm not exactly sure how far it goes beyond there, but I think the idea is eventually it sort of gets you connected to Villanova somehow, right?
Well, I think the next section would be up to the 476 Blue Route on-ramp, and then... We had to figure out how to get across, but there is a nice piece of the old trail that's in that neighborhood, and so that would be a nice extension.
The other work group that we typically have is the Green Team work group. I've taken it off our list this year, towards the end of last year, just because we hadn't had any momentum going and we had a hard time getting things scheduled. So. If that changes, we can put that back on here. But right now, those four things we just talked about are really where we have our efforts right now. And I think, of course, we'll take things from the community as they come up and from the commissioners as they come up. But that's kind of where I think we should spend our time this year. I think it's a lot, but I think it's manageable. Next order of business is community environmental education and awareness. I don't have anything to report on that. Skip?
I was going to say Matt's thing is sort of that. I mean, the water testing and the insect retrieval, and et cetera. So, I mean, I think we are doing something.
I didn't mean that we weren't doing anything. I just don't have anything new to report. Of course, my daughter wanted to talk about recycling in the lunchroom at Wayne Elementary School, but I said that we've already talked about that. Oh. So.
How about an update?
No, it's okay. We're all right. Skip, can you give us a Planning Commission liaison report?
Well, I'd like to invite anyone who's interested in the 145 King of Prussia Road site, also known as Biomed, also now known as Penn Medicine, to attend on Monday. We have a special meeting dedicated purely and solely to that topic, basically the new ordinance for the PLO. And I've seen things this week that I think they're posted on the website as early as today or yesterday, but there's some new, more concise and detailed at the same time traffic information. Of course, there's a red line version of the ordinance to compare it to where we were earlier. So the entire meeting will be on that, and that's Monday night. There's the usual other things going on, like Wellwyn and Cambria Court and things like that, but nothing of the size of the PLO piece.
Were you saying there is a draft version of the proposed ordinance on site or on the website, or is it available?
Phil is here. Basically, it's the latest version that we've received from the commissioners. Okay. And we're instructed or charged with commenting and perhaps offering some suggestions that are different.
So folks who want to look at it, study it, think about it before the meeting, do they go to the township website?
They could, but probably it's better to attend. Because otherwise you're going through, 30 or 40 pages in a vacuum.
Okay.
Whereas in the midst of a traffic study, one of us will say, does this mean that X?
Okay. So this is the Monday meeting is a sort of interactive discussion with
No, it's an official Planning Commission meeting. It's not a presentation.
Okay.
Per se, except that there'll be information that hasn't been presented before. Okay. Some. Mainly some of its traffic. Also, the Delaware County Planning Commission board or whatever that reviews all ordinances has made comments. There's their letters possibly on the website. I'm not sure, but that'll certainly be discussed a little bit on Monday.
Okay. Good.
I mean, it's a big project.
And this isn't the final, vote or anything?
It could be from planning. It could be.
Okay.
I mean, it's not the first time we've looked at this.
Right. You've looked at it several
For several years, right. So, and different versions, et cetera.
Okay.
This is the streamlined version compared to where we were.
Okay.
We had a very extensive document at one time.
Right.
That's, from what I can tell, I would say gone.
Okay.
And maybe that's okay.
Do you have any comments on the current version that you want to share?
I would prefer not to.
Understood. Well, it's good to know.
I mean, everybody has a list of things that they have lost,
Right, right.
I mean, since we're at EAC, one thing I can tell you that never seems to get into the final version is a slightly larger riparian buffer. It's still 35 feet in the current version that we're going to comment on, and I'm going to say 50 feet on Monday, but
right. That
doesn't mean it'll happen.
Okay. Well, it's worth making that push.
And in some of the older versions, we used to have one more thing, I guess, and it's EAC-ish, so it seems fair. We used to have a requirement there would be a certain amount of parking dedicated to rideshare. And I think that one of us has mentioned maybe some charging stations per so many thousand parking spaces. But that's not in this version right now either. Some of that could be market-driven. I mean, if everybody has Teslas, your office building won't be successful unless you have charging stations. Mm-hmm. But that being said, I wonder how many people would have handicapped spots unless they had to.
Right. Right. So it was in, those provisions were in a previous version?
Some of them were.
And they're not in this, this version? And
we'll give one opinion. The other version was so convoluted and long to excess that it might have had problems in operation.
Okay.
traffic neutrality is a tough concept, and that was a big, that was pages and pages, and I never really liked it. Okay. So I like the newer version to the extent that it attempts to control traffic in a more effective way, and in a, probably in a more enforceable way. I mean, one salient feature is that in the mixed-use language, it talks about that the maximum square footage per acre, no matter how tall the building is or how long it is 25,500 square feet. Now, that's a lot of coverage for an acre, but that still is an absolute, you know, red line that you can't cross when you build.
Right.
Plus so, setbacks, et cetera.
Okay.
But we'll be here for a couple hours. You can tune in.
Okay, good.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thanks, Skip. 35-foot riparian buffer.
Yeah.
It's really small.
Well, that's in most of the rest of the, you know, code.
Is it?
Yeah. That's what we've, that's the status quo. And I don't know if that, I know we recommended to the commissioners 50-foot on the version we turned in August, but it still isn't there.
PADP recommends
say it again.
Something like 100 feet.
100, yeah.
Well, yeah, I think that would be hard to find in a local code, but 50 you could probably find and should, and we should have it too.
Okay, thanks. And but by the way, I wanted to, and I'm not pandering to our audience here. I can you give us a? I didn't realize that there was any on-site sewerage in this township, new like as a new construction. Can you give us a brief introduction into that topic?
Well, sometimes we're in a meeting and we rely on staff, and the developer or builder will say, you know, we're allowed to do on-site septic there. And if staff doesn't say, no, you're not, or I think one of the reasons why they were doing it, I believe that there's a little bit of a problem right now for new construction to hook up to the sewer system. I think that's what's holding up in part the project at Bloomingdale and West Wayne. Because I don't know if you drive past it, but they're like four townhouses with mansard roofs, and it's just like they're not being finished.
Yes.
And I heard something about that at one of the meetings, and I apologize for not having precise detail, but I think he can't hook up just yet.
Okay. All right.
Maybe there was a mistake with their, you know, their sewer module or whatever it is, but I've heard that.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
You know, when I moved into my home, there was an old septic system. I mean, most of it, and also actually Atlee Road only got sewers the bottom half near Mill Dam about 10 years ago.
And when they put those sewers in, they probably required everybody to...
No, there's two or three people that never hooked up and don't have to.
Okay.
They're on the other side of that little stream.
Right, right. And obviously this would be a process that would be overseen by the township engineer and various other authorities that is done correctly,
right.
And whatnot. Okay.
And just because you don't hook up to start doesn't mean you can't hook up. Wellwind curiously has the sewer in the street for everybody else right now. But like I said, you don't have to.
Mm-hmm.
I apparently don't have to.
Okay. Thank you. It's the end of our liaison. Unless you had anything to talk about from Shade Tree that was of interest. I would never ask you for a liaison report from Shade Tree.
Nothing extraordinary. I mean, we review plans and, you know, we do our Shade Tree thing. And I would say that there might still be one vacancy, but I'm not sure. We were a little shorthanded midsummer.
Are they involved? I think there's another tree giveaway or...
Well, we were supposed to have someone from the Conservancy speak about that, and she could not attend.
Okay.
So I have nothing to report on that.
Okay. And they didn't get into the bamboo issue?
It will be addressed in February, and someone asked Jack if he was waiting to hear from EAC, and he said yes, but I think he did, and he just maybe...
Forgot.
Didn't remember.
Okay.
That he had.
Okay. All right. So maybe
we'll make contact. Yeah. Okay. We'll make contact with him.
Okay.
All right. Are there any other old business that we haven't covered already? Or any new business? No, and we've already had our public comment, unless there's any other public comment. Matt, you want to take the gavel?
I will take the gavel. If there's no other business, do I have a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Second.
All right. Approved. Thank you, everyone.